this very thing in action, and the rest of them are going to tell you about one of the stories.
Martha cares for Jesus and his disciples in her home.
A good Samaritan cared for a hurt stranger.
A boy shares his lunch.
Simon carries Jesus' cross.
Mary puts perfume on Jesus.
Dorcas gives clothes to people who are in need.
Amen. And can we all do this? Ladies and gentlemen, are these hard things to do? No, they're not. And we're all going to be sheep, aren't we? On the what side of Jesus? The right side of Jesus. All right, can we give them a round of applause for doing that for us this morning? Now we have a video which Carmen, she disappeared. Oh, there she is. And her husband made to show you what goes on in Sabbath school, because I want you to know that there is a mission field right here in this church, and it happens in these rooms back here. And this is very important work that we do, because every one of these children is a soul for the kingdom. So we're now going to let you see a little bit about what happens back in those rooms.
Okay, we're rolling.
Loves me, this I know, for the Bible.
Amen. I want to close our time together with prayer, but before we do that, I really want to have each one of you remember the children of our church in your prayers every day. These are very important people. They are the church that's coming along. And the other thing I want you to do is think about what you can do to help with this mission field. Because this stuff on Sabbath morning doesn't happen on its own. It happens with the devotion and the dedication of a lot of hardworking people. So if there's anything that you can do to help out with any of the Sabbath school divisions, it would be very appreciated. Can we bow our heads? Dear Father in heaven, we do thank you so much for each one of these souls that is here presented to you on this 13th Sabbath. We thank you so much that we have children. They are a blessing from you. Now, Lord, we pray a blessing on this Sabbath day. We pray a blessing on all the families. We pray a blessing on our church family. Keep us in all we do. May we worship you in perfection and in truth. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
above all nature and all creation.
Gospel commission given by Jesus Christ himself, that we should go and make disciples of all people. Here at Tampa First, we have a multicultural church. We have people from all walks of life, different cultural backgrounds from South America, Central America, the West Indies, even in Africa, Southeast Asia, and Europe. We're all here together worshiping one God and Creator and Savior, Jesus Christ. Here at Tampa First, we interpret the Gospel Commission of making disciples in three different parts. Number one, we love God by worshiping Him through inspiring worship. Number two, we nurture others through holistic small groups. By becoming smaller, we grow larger. And finally, the overarching thing is that we want to equip and empower others to serve by using their spiritual gifts and allowing them an opportunity to discover their gifts and using their gifts in the body and in the community. Here at Tampa First, with our multicultural environment, we have many different activities. We have Pathfinders. We have many things for our young people. We have Tampa Adventist Academy, pre-K through 11th grade school, soon to be 12th grade school, where we minister to the needs of many different people, many walks of life here in the Tampa region. And so we here at Tampa First really appreciate what God has given us, the ministry opportunities He's given us. And ultimately, we want to serve Jesus Christ. We want to surrender our lives to the one who has already saved us through His death and His resurrection. We look forward as Seventh-day Adventist Christians here at Tampa First that Jesus Christ is coming back soon. So whether you come here to visit us for vacation, or whether you're coming here to relocate with work or your family, we welcome you. So come and join us, and God will not only bless you, but He will bless us for your presence here.
Well, good morning, church family. Good to see you out on a beautiful, sunny, and warm Florida morning. Allow me to draw your attention to a few announcements that you will find in your bulletin, and that is next Sabbath after second service, we will not be having fellowship dinner. It's that time of year, so make other dinner arrangements. The Lord is good, is He not? And because of that, we have wonderful things that happen at our church. The first one being that we have our communion service coming up, which is the third Sabbath in July. We also have our Vacation Bible School, and you don't have to be 5, 10, or 12 years old to come. We need lots of volunteers, and once again, our pastor's wife, Julie, will be leading out with that. And so we have many things happening in our church, and we are thankful that we can come and worship our Lord and Savior this morning. At this time, we will be having our children's story. And Monique Haynes is here to share with us, and as the children come up, they take up an offering for Tampa Adventist Academy. So if you would hold those dollar bills up nice and high and wave them, and as the children come up, they'll be collecting them and putting them in our little schoolhouse this morning. Thank you.
Happy Sabbath, everyone. How are you doing today? You know, I read an awesome Bible verse the other day. It goes like this. How precious also are your thoughts to me, O God. How vast is the sum of them. If I should count them, they would outnumber the sands. Let me show you what I mean. Okay, I'm going to pour out the sand, and I want you to count them. Are you ready? How many grains of sand do you think is in here? Any guesses?
100.
Is there any, you want to guess?
I think it is 2.
2? Okay. Are you sure about that? Okay. I'm going to pour it out one more time, and you guys guess again. How many do you think is in there now?
2.
2? Okay. Well, if God has that many thoughts about you and I and the world, that's a lot. Like the verse says, we can't even add them up. God is constantly thinking about us. Is that amazing? We are always on his mind. He cares about us that much. Does anyone want to pray today? Can I have 2 volunteers or 1?
Jesus, thank you for this day. Thank you for the church. Thank you for our families and friends. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
If you turn your Bibles with me to Philippians chapter 4, Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. You should have a Bible in front of you in the pew. Philippians chapter 4. And because this is prayer time, you're probably thinking, I'm going to read, be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, right? We all know this passage, or we've heard of it, not to be anxious about anything, but to come with prayer. But that's not the one I want to read. I want to call your attention as some of you start bringing your prayer requests up to our box, as you start writing your prayer request. The passage that I want to read during this time, it's Philippians chapter 4, but it's verse 8. And it says, finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are novel, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are good of good report, if there is any virtue, if there is anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. As you write your prayer request, you're probably thinking of all the negative and that you need to bring to God and say, I need help with this and that, or we need to pray for so-and-so. And a lot of times we focus about the anxious part, but we forget to meditate on the good things, right? So I want to invite you, as we come down for a garden of prayer, as you bring your prayer request, how about we think for a change on the good things that the Lord has done? Pastoral staff, we read the prayer request cards every week, and most of them are things that are heavy in our hearts, and it's okay. But what if today we focus on, not only on those, but on the good things that God has given us, on the lovely things, the pure things, the novel things that he has done in our lives. I'd like to invite you, if you have a special prayer request or something special you'd like to be thankful for, to come down here and join me for a garden of prayer. If you're visiting us today, our prayer request cards are in the bulletin. You can tear it on the side, and anytime during the worship service, if you didn't get a chance to finish it, you can just bring it to the front. We have a box, and you can just put it in there. As far as possible, I'd like to invite all of us to kneel. our dear God, our Daddy, our loving Savior, we come this morning with great joy, with great thanksgiving for what you have done in our lives, for the beautiful gift of salvation through Jesus Christ, because in him you've promised us to forgive us for our sins. Lord, we come this morning as sinners in great need of you, and we present ourselves to you and we say thank you. Thank you for the forgiveness. Thank you for the removal of our sins. Thank you for giving us and creating in us a new heart. Thank you because today we can say we have been crucified with Christ and it is no longer us who lives, but Christ who lives in us. Lord, we look good this morning. We've got our nice clothes on. We've got our smiles, but you know exactly what's in our hearts. You know our dreams, you know our happy moments, the things that we can come and be thankful for. But you also know our needs, our brokenness, our prayer requests for a loved one, for health, for salvation, for those who are struggling with addiction. And you know it all, and you take care of it all, because you tell us that before we ask, you already have an answer. So we're so grateful for that. Father, I'm thankful today that in 1 Corinthians, you tell us that you will never give us more than we can handle. And so today, we would like to be grateful for that, because every prayer request that has been written with so much faith, you already knew it, and you're already working it. It's not catching you by surprise. So we thank you for that. We praise you, Lord, for our church family, for our families, for those who love us, for those who encourage us, for those who have blessed us this week. We're grateful, Lord, for the so many ways you spoke to our hearts. Father, we ask today for those who are serving this country, bless them, protect them. We pray for our nurses, our teachers, our police officers, those who are constantly giving their lives to make a difference in our communities. Bless them, anoint them. Thank you, Father God, that today we will worship you and praise your name and we get to hear a message. We ask that you will anoint Pastor Brad and that he will be filled with the Holy Spirit and that he will speak in power and truth, Lord. And I pray that each one of us will remove obstacles and will allow you to speak to us. I pray for our young people, Lord, in the balcony. I pray for them that they will be willing to hear a message that will speak to them because they are so amazing and special to our church. We love them so much, Lord. Thank you that you've created them to be movers and shakers for your kingdom. Thank you, Father. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. This is that special time in our worship service where we get to participate by our faithfulness and returning to the Lord what's His. Amen. It's our tithe and offering time. And I think I might have already told you guys this story. We were giving one of my daughters, which I will not say names, just in case she's paying attention, would give her money. You can figure out which one, right? We would give her money for Jesus, and if it was a lot of coins, she would give her money for Jesus, but what would she do? She keeps some, right? She's smart. Or at least, you know, according to what the world teaches. She kept some for herself. She gave to Jesus, but she kept some. And we had to tell her, no, this money is all for Jesus, because it's all His, right? And I'm wondering how many times we do the same thing. We know that this is the money for Jesus. We know it should be all His, but we keep some, right? Because it gives us maybe a sense of security, because maybe it's gonna be there for a rainy day, whatever the reason it is, but I'd like to invite you today to return what belongs to him, all the money for Jesus. You know how much that is. We believe in the 10% tithe. We believe God has asked us for offering, and it's not an option. If we read in Malachi 3:10, it tells us to bring to him his tithe and offerings. It's really interesting. In the summer, our giving goes really low. It goes down. And we talk and we say, what is it? Do people use it for vacation? No, not for vacation. They use it for mission trips, maybe. Or maybe to help the poor. We don't know why in the summer it goes low. But all we know is that we want to be faithful to him. Amen? And we want to return what's his. So today, as I ask the deacons to stand, as we pray, that we will worship him through giving. Father God, for some reason I've been there. It just seems a little nice to keep some money for a rainy day. Who knows, maybe to help someone else. But today we want to be faithful to you. And we want to return everything that belongs to you. You've given us so much and you ask for so little in return. And I thank you, Lord, that as we are faithful to you today, that we will be blessed. Our church has had a very low month financially, but at the end of the day, we do not worry, because just like in each one of our individual lives, you always come through, you will come through to us as well. Father, we pray for every person that faithfully returns what belongs to you. We ask for a special blessing in their finances, on their lives, every area of their lives. We also pray for those who are contemplating, trusting you. We pray for them as you talk to them and you continue to lead them to come to this decision to be faithful to you with their tithe and offerings. And we pray for all of those who are just maybe very resistant, Lord. We thank you that you love them too. And that you are a loving Father that takes us where we're at and lead us where we need to be. So we thank you, Lord. May we be good stewards of your money. In Jesus' name, amen.
Surround myself a secret space in the shelter of Almighty love, in the safety of the Savior's arms. I will run to the hiding place. The hiding place. Draw me ever closer to look upon your face. I will run to the hiding place. Draw me ever closer to look upon your face. I will run to the hiding place.
Amen. This morning, I woke up thinking what I was going to say to you guys this morning. And God inspired me to write this, and I'm going to read it because I don't want to forget anything about it. We are going through an oil crisis.
Please stand with us for our next song.
Hide me now under your wings. Cover me within your mind.
When the oceans rise and thunders roar, I will soar with you above the storm. Father, you are king over the flood. I will be still and know you.
Amen.
And Lord, Heavenly Father, we ask you to remind us of our
Let's pray. We are amazed by you, Lord. Your love is so deep, we can't even comprehend it. And Lord, now I pray that you will settle us in as we culminate our worship in your word. There's a lot of distractions, Lord. So many of us might even be the knockout round of the World Cup today. Let's not worry about that. We don't want to worry about all the things. Lord, we want to be centered and grounded in you today. So, Lord, bless us as, Lord, we hear from your word that you would speak through me, that we would be changed in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Adopted. We've talked about this before in our study of the book of Galatians. When I say adoption, it might ring in your ears very closely. You might have a family member or a friend, or maybe you yourself have been a product of adoption. Maybe some of you have spent time in foster homes, which is like a temporary adoption. Or maybe, just maybe, you were blessed by a big brother or a big sister. There are so many ways in which we can help compensate in this life of sin to help young people, to help children who might not have the benefit of a functional home life. But I can share this with you today, no matter what your disappointment in your home, no matter what joy you've had in your home, that there's an adoption that is greater than any parent you could ever have in this life. That's being adopted by God through faith in Jesus Christ. Today we're going to continue our study in the book of Galatians. We're going to go to Galatians chapter 3 in the series Good News. And we're going to talk about being a child of God. So turn with me in your Bibles to Galatians chapter 3, starting with verse 26. That's page 1339 in your pew Bibles. If you haven't brought your own Bible, in front of you there's a burgundy Bible, not the hymnal. You'll see numbers, not pages. But if you don't have it in front of you, down the row you might see one, a burgundy pew Bible. It's 1339 in your pew Bibles. Galatians chapter 3, starting with verse 26. Paul's talking to the people in Galatia, and in context, he was sharing with the Jewish folk that, hey, to be a child of Abraham isn't about bloodline. It's not about your heritage or how long you've been a Jew. Being a child of Abraham is being a child of promise, and being a child of promise is to be a child of faith in Jesus Christ. And so that is the context as we pick it up in verse 26. Paul says, for you are all sons of God through faith in Jesus Christ. Mark your finger on that as we go to 27. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. There is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor what? Nor free. There is neither male nor female. For you are all one in who? Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ's, then you are Abraham's seed and what? Heirs according to the promise. Heirs according to the promise. You are all sons of God by working your way to that point? Is that what it says? You are sons and daughters. You are children of God. Through what? Through faith in whom? In Jesus Christ. You are a child of God through faith in Jesus Christ. The key to be a child of God is to have faith in Jesus Christ, to have faith as Abraham had, who was called to leave Ur without having a clue on what would happen. He took that step of faith. Some of you today need to take that step of faith in Jesus Christ. Do you want to be a child, an heir, according to the promise? Not the promises of this world, not the promises of our sinful society, but the promise that God had given Adam and Eve in the garden, that there would be a seed who would crush the head of the serpent in sin. His name is Jesus. Are you that heir today? As we look at these verses, we find out that for as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ. Think about baptism. Many of us have seen baptism. Liam, my son, just was baptized a couple weeks ago at Camp Kalakwa. We'll show you some pictures. In fact, Pastor William had put them on his website for those of you who'd like to see. I think it's on Facebook at the church. It's a wonderful thing, baptism. But is there really anything magical about the waters of baptism? Is it special holy water that we put in the baptismal tank? No, baptism is an outward expression of what has already happened in your heart. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ, verse 27. Baptism is an indication that by faith you've accepted your death and resurrection in Jesus Christ. Amen. Jesus died for the sins of the world, and he's not in the tomb, but Jesus Christ is alive. And when you die to self in sin, you are resurrected in the life of Jesus Christ. Turn with me in your Bibles to Romans chapter 6, verse 11 to 13. Romans chapter 6, verses 11 to 13. That's page 1299 in your pew Bibles. Just the pew Bibles. Not everyone else's Bible, unless you have the same version. In addition, 1299, Romans chapter 6, verses 11 to 13. What happens when we take that step of faith, when we become a child of God through Jesus Christ? What happens? Paul says this in the context of dead to sin and alive to God. Romans chapter 6, starting with verse 11. He says, likewise, you also reckon yourselves to be dead indeed to sin. You consider yourselves to be dead to sin. But alive to God where? In Christ Jesus our Lord. Therefore, do not let sin what? Who reigns? When we think of reigning, a king, right? A power. What is the power in your life? What is controlling your life? Is God controlling your life? Is the righteousness of Jesus controlling your life? Or is sin reigning in your life? Notice, don't let sin reign. When you're a child of God, when he changes your life, he changes your attitude, he changes your path. But he gives you a choice every day, doesn't he? He gives you a choice. You have a choice. Choose you this day whom you will serve. But will you say with Joshua, but as for me and my house, what? We will serve the Lord. Have you made that decision today? Now, do you have confession time with the Lord? I hope that you had confession time last night or this morning. I hope you confess to the Lord many times. Because there are times we need to confess and ask for forgiveness. Amen? Through the blood of Jesus Christ, we can be forgiven. Let me share this with you, folks. It doesn't say, don't let sin creep in. It happens sometimes. God doesn't want it to. But don't let sin reign. Some of you are into the bondages of sin in your life. You're in Egypt like the children of Israel. There's addiction that you can't overcome. It's reigning. You might have worries, and it's reigning. It's reigning. It's controlling you. You might have obsessive compulsive issues that might be in your genetic code, and it's keeping God from fully dwelling and reigning in your life. Give it to the Lord. You are new in Jesus Christ and alive in Jesus. Don't let sin reign. Because the answer isn't your power. The answer isn't all you do. The answer is in giving yourself over to the one who can give you victory. His name is Jesus. His name is Jesus. As we continue on, therefore, verse 12, do not let sin reign in your mortal body, that you should obey it in its lust. Verse 13, and do not present your members as instruments of unrighteousness to sin, but present yourselves to God as being alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. Present yourself as alive. You are alive in Jesus. Amen? Act like you're alive. I talk to Christians, and they act like they're dead. The walking dead. Like some crazy horror flick in Hollywood. Act like you're alive. Because you are alive in Jesus. You are alive. He's alive and you're alive if we'd only let him in your life. Don't act like you're dead. Don't act like you're dead. That's just terrible. When you say you're a Christian, you act like you're dead. Oh, I don't know. I this and this. Be alive in Jesus. Let your light so shine. It says here back in Galatians 3:13-39 in your pew Bibles, for as many as you were baptized in Christ have put on Christ. What does it mean to put on Christ? I think of the parable of the wedding feast in Matthew 22. God is symbolized by the one who organized it. The bridegroom is Jesus. Those who were called initially were the Jewish people, but they rejected the invitation, didn't they? And so he went to the highways and byways and called people to this great feast, symbolic of the feast in heaven, right? But when they got there, it was important that they did what? Put on the robe. That robe is symbolized by Christ's righteousness. Not your efforts, not what you can do. Your righteousness is as filthy rags, according to the prophet Isaiah. Put on Jesus. When you're baptized and you're alive, you put on Jesus. Put on Jesus. And a lot of kids nowadays like to have all these fancy stuff. Well, the LeBrons are out now, right? LeBrons. I don't know anything about LeBrons. Now I do. What's the new one, Mason? Oh, the South Beach LeBrons. Ah, Coach knows what I'm talking about. Now we just got the South Beach ones. Anyway, the point is I'm looking at all these things and all the things that sometimes when we get, and listen, it's not just clothes and LeBrons, right? I'm trying to connect with the kids here. Are we all right? Amen? Some of you older kids that know what I'm talking about. But you know what? You can't put anything on but the robe of Jesus Christ when you go to heaven. You can't be hanging on to your LeBrons or your car or your house. You can't be holding on to your kids or your wife. You need to hold on to Jesus. He'll take care of you. Do you believe that? Because there's disappointments in this life. Your shoes get ripped up. Your car gets old. And someone else has something better. But Jesus is the answer for all things. In all days. But there's a man who came and he wore his own clothes, wore his own robe. And the master said, hey, where's your robe? I don't need it. I got my own. I got my own righteousness. Isn't it cool? I got the nice suit on. I got this. This is Armani suit. I don't know what I'm wearing. I got the best. And God looks at him and said, I told you to put on the robe of righteousness. And that's not good enough. Bye. Bye. And he cast him out. If you don't have Jesus, you're not going to have eternity. That's the choice we have to make today. Let me be blunt about this. Let me be clear about this. If you have Jesus, and if you choose Jesus, then you have eternity. You don't. It's not God's fault, because his promises are always yes, and you will go to hell. You will go to hell. Some people don't believe hell's real. Even in this congregation, some people are just kind of, oh, it's just something out there. No, the reality is this. God, through Jesus Christ, everything's yes. But if you reject Jesus, you don't have any options. Do we need Jesus today? Do we need Jesus more than ever? Notice what it says. There's neither Jew or Greek, slave or free, male or female. All are one in Christ. Here at Tampa First, we have 50, 60 cultures represented. We're all going, yeah, we know all about that. You know, God is colorblind. God has no favoritism when it comes to the language that you come from, the continent that you live in. He doesn't really care. He's not a respecter of that. He just wants you to be his child. Some people say, well, what language does God speak? Well, I have a seminary professor back when I was in seminary, Dr. Davidson. He tried to convince us that God's language was Hebrew. Because obviously it's some form of that language was written on those tablets of stone at Sinai, right? I'll never forget my first Hebrew class. I did Greek. I knew Spanish. I learned Spanish. I went to seminary with an undergraduate degree in pre-medicine. So I didn't know what was hitting me. Greek was all right. You know, Greek kind of connects a little bit with the English language, Spanish language. I got to Hebrew. And where do we start? I got my Bible. I still have a big brown Bible. I should have brought it out. And I'm looking. Go to page 1. Page 1 is at the end, not the beginning, and you read from right to left. I knew I was in a little bit of trouble. Starting from the beginning. But that's where God wants us. And by the way, I don't know if Hebrew is the heavenly language. I don't really care. I just want to be a child of God. There's neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, right? All are one in Christ Jesus. And if you're Christ, then you're Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. Notice, you are an heir, not by how long you've been an Adventist or how long you've been a Christian or how good you've been. You're an heir because of Jesus Christ. And God promises us eternity. He promises the human race eternity through Jesus Christ. The only thing stopping you from heaven is you. If you choose to reject Jesus, you reject heaven. God promised this to Abraham. He promised it to Adam and Eve when he said that Jesus, the seed, would crush the head of the serpent. His promises are always yes. But if you don't want them and you don't open the free gift, you won't have eternity. How sad. Continue on in Galatians, now chapter 4. Somebody say, why are you going to 2 chapters today? Well, sometimes chapter divisions don't always work, okay? Sometimes if you're reading, why is it stopping here? Because the next verse and the next chapter kind of fits. So we're going to continue on, all right? I'm not doing the whole chapter, trust me. Chapter 4, verse 1. Now I say that the heir, as long as he is a child, does not differ at all from a slave, though he is a master of all, but is under guardians and stewards until the time appointed by the father. Think about this. So what do you mean he's no different than those who are servants in the household? He's an heir. She's an heir. This child is an heir and is deserving of all the blessings of the household. But let's be honest, folks. When you're raising up children, do you give them too much responsibility when not ready? How many times have you seen kids driving Ferraris at 16? Good idea? No. I don't care if you're worth $1 billion. Don't give your daughter or son a Ferrari for their 16th birthday. There's bad ideas, aren't there? Okay, a little concession here. I remember in Hershey, Pennsylvania, the Reese's grandfather, he's passed away now, he sold the Reese's company to Hershey Chocolate. So I think that you could say that the Reese's family has some money. They own like 30 McDonald's. That was just a start. That was just one child of his family. And the grandchildren were in school with me. They're both similar ages. I think one was the same age, one was a little younger. And they would drive their new Porsches to school. Yeah, like 911s. And we're talking about like little like junky ones, like 944s that kind of sputter. We're talking about the good stuff. It was all fun until they had snow and they're all spinning around. Then we told them to park it and leave it there. But you know, the reality is those kids actually went through a lot of trouble because they gave them so much and they didn't know how to handle the responsibility. And so you see that an heir, yes, there's an heir, but they needed to be under a tutor. Remember we talked about last time, what was the tutor for the children of Israel to get them to Jesus? What was the tutor? The law, remember? Because they were in Egypt for so long, they didn't understand God or Jesus, and so God gave them the law to bring them as a tutor to Jesus. The law is an end of itself. It's a transcript of God's character, but it was to lead them to Jesus. Unfortunately, when Jesus arrived, they were still working with the tutor. You know, is a tutor good? How many of you think a tutor is good? But the tutor can be only so effective, right? How many of you are teachers and know what I'm talking about? Because at the end, the person needs to make some steps. The child, the student, needs to make some steps. The good news is we're going to find out here in the next verses that which shows us our sin when we accept Jesus Christ, that same law that shows us our sin is written in our hearts. Amen? The character of God through Jesus Christ. Verse 3 of chapter 4, even so, when we were children, we were in bondage under the elements of the world. How many of you remember when you were in bondage? Some of you are in bondage today. Some of you are in terrible bondage today, and sin has a chokehold in your life. You come to church, and you're being choked out. You're in bondage, and you're struggling, and you're trying to be a good father, you're trying to be a good mother, you're trying to be a good husband and wife, and you just can't do it because sin has shackled you down. And you're trying, and you're trying, and you're trying, and you're not making it. You'll never make it. You will never make it. You won't, but God can. You need to tap into the source. The source who has the power and victory over sin. You need to give your life to Jesus Christ. Amen? Put on that robe. And every day he'll give you the power to surrender. And I guarantee you that you will have victory from the bondage. Think about the children of Israel. Were they in bondage? Where were they in bondage? Egypt. They lost sight of God. And when God called them out after the plagues, they put the blood of the lamb. They didn't even understand the whole concept of that, but they did it anyway. And they went out there, and when they came to the throes of the Red Sea, and they were pressed by Pharaoh, who changed his mind, what did God do? He parted the sea, and they walked across on dry land. Some of you need the sea parted today. Some of you need that sea parted today. You need to walk on dry ground because you feel like you're just going to either go backwards and get slaughtered by what's happening, or you're going to fall into the ocean and just die. There is a way out of your predicament. There is a way out of your dilemma, and that way out is Jesus. Jesus. Jesus is the answer because you're a child of God through faith in Jesus Christ. Verses 4 and 5. But when, notice, I like the but. Remember the conjunctions? Schoolhouse Rock again. Conjunction, junction, what's your function? The function in this is to give a contrast. But when the fullness of time had come, in contrast to being in bondage to sin, get this, you've heard it before, this is the context. But when the fullness of time had come, God sent forth his Son. Born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those who were under the law, that we might receive the adoptions as sons. When you're dead to rights, Jesus Christ came. The fullness of time. Daniel chapter 9 shares with us, at least in the arena of when the Messiah would come. Micah shares with us that he would come to Ephrathah or Bethlehem. In fact, the Jewish scholars knew that and helped Herod direct the wise men to where he would be. Balaam's prophecy in the book of Numbers shares with us that there'd be a star. And that's how the wise men came from the east. There was prophecies, and there was the hope and the desire that Jesus would come. And at the fulfillment of time, Jesus came and was born of a woman who never knew a man. God planted the seed of his Son in the woman. Amen. Miraculous. Couldn't happen. And Jesus came to this earth, and the people at that time were under the bondage of the law. They hadn't found Jesus. They didn't understand why they were sacrificing things. They're trying to keep the law to be saved. They didn't understand, folks. Jesus came and placed himself under the bondage of that society and under the law, and he kept the law. He redeemed us from the curse of the law. Amen. And that same law that condemns us, because the character of God will always condemn you, that law that condemns us because of our sin, when we accept Jesus, he writes it on your heart. And you can sing with David in that psalm, I delight in your law. I delight in your law. I don't delight in it so I can keep it to be saved. I delight in it because I'm saved. Because I'm saved. We are adopted. We are adopted. Notice verse 5. We are adopted as sons and daughters through Jesus Christ. Aren't you glad that we have a heavenly parent, a heavenly father who will never disappoint us? How many of you have ever been disappointed by your parents? Come on, they're not watching. I won't put the camera on you. How many of you maybe have been a disappointment to your children sometimes? They're not watching. Well, maybe they are. Aren't you glad you have a heavenly father who will never disappoint you? Never, ever disappoint you. Yes, you might be in pain because of what happened in your family life. Yes, you might be in pain right now because of your current situation. You might be in pain because of the bondage of sin that is shackled to your ankles and to your body. But rest assured, you have an answer because you have been adopted through Jesus Christ, and your heavenly Father is your Father. How many of you believe today that God will never disappoint you? He'll never, ever disappoint you. There's no inconsistency. There's no conditional love. There's no loving one child more than the other. When I start to dig a little bit, I'll pull away. Right? You know what I mean. The good news is, we're children of God through Jesus. In verses 6 and 7, and because you are sons and because you are daughters, God has sent forth the Spirit of His Son into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. Therefore, you are no longer a slave, amen, but a son. And if a son, then an heir of God through Christ. You're an heir, not just an heir of something in this world. You're beyond the heir of the Gates fortune or the fortune of Sam Walton's children. Walmart, keep growing, don't they? You are an heir of eternity through Jesus Christ. And there's no money, there's no billions and trillions and whatever, quadrillions of dollars that can pay for eternity. There are rich people who are dying who want to live longer. They're freezing themselves, hoping that they have an answer for the cancer that they had. Freeze you right before you die. Cryogenics or whatever they called it. You know what? There's only one eternity. It's through Jesus Christ. That's one eternity. But notice he says he will give you the Spirit. Verse 6. As you cry into your hearts, crying out, Abba, Father. Who cries out, Abba, Father? Who cries out? Look at the passage. Who cries out? The Spirit, right? Think about that. Turn with me in your Bibles as we're nearing conclusion today. Romans chapter 8, verse 26. Romans 8, 26. That's page 1301 in your pew Bibles. Romans 8, 26. How many of you feel sometimes in your life that you're crying out to God and it's just hitting the ceiling? Come on. It happens. You don't even know what to pray. You're so discouraged. It's so difficult. You're just throwing prayers up in the name of Jesus, and you're not too sure. This is a Bible promise. Listen to this, Romans 8, 26. Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our weaknesses, for we do not know what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit Himself makes what? Intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Who makes the groanings? The Spirit makes the groanings. And when you're down and out and you're flat on your back, when you're discouraged and you can't get past your past, present, future, God hears your prayer. God hears your prayer. The Holy Spirit takes your puny prayer, takes your quasi pathetic prayer, and turns them into a wonderful, melodious song in the presence of God. Your prayers are heard. No matter what you're going through, trust in God. You're his child. You're a child of God. You're a son of God. You're a daughter of God through Jesus Christ, based on a promise, not based on a contract, not based on if you're good enough, I'll let you be my child. You're a child of God through the promise given to Adam and Eve and to Abraham through Jesus Christ. The question isn't about God's promise, and God never, ever breaks his promise. That's the new covenant, right? We talked about this last time. What's older, the old covenant given to the children of Israel at Sinai or the new covenant given to Adam and Eve and Abraham? What's older? Come on, say it. The new covenant's older. New and old have nothing to do with age. It has to do with the reality in Jesus. Amen. I want to be a child of God, a child of promise. I am a child of Abraham through Jesus Christ. Now, being a child of Abraham means that sometimes God's going to ask me, he's going to ask you to make a step of faith, to leave Ur, right? And you don't know where you're going, but he's going to call you to take a step, right? And you're going to have to go forward, not too sure what it means, but you're going to go forward by faith, and he will always provide. He will always provide for you because you are his child, you are his son, you are his daughter, and you are a child of promise, a child of the Most High who reigns forever and ever, and he wants to reign in your life. Forget sin reigning in your life. Have God reign in your life. God reigns. I want you to consider that as I call the praise team forward. We are children of God in Christ. As we place our trust in his sacrifice, we are heirs of eternity. Amen? Heirs of eternity in the beloved. Think about that as we sing our final song.
my Savior, I come to thee.
Let us pray. We need you every hour, Lord. We've talked about children. We talked about being a child of God. Some here today have been very disappointed by their childhood, disappointed by people who are supposed to protect them and haven't. Lord, I want to, just in your presence, in the presence of the holy angels and your Son and the Holy Spirit, give encouragement to people to know that there is a Father in heaven, you, Father, who will never disappoint, who will never break his promises. And Lord, in your presence, I believe there might be someone here today who has never really accepted your Son, Jesus Christ. Because we know that we're children when we accept Jesus. You know who you are, and you need Jesus. And the Holy Spirit is saying to you, you heard the sermon, you've worshiped, now's the time. Today's the day for your salvation. If you are the person today who the Holy Spirit is calling you to accept Jesus Christ and be called an adopted son or daughter of God, the Most High God of this universe, say yes to Jesus right now. Confess in your heart that you're a sinner. Confess in your heart that you're a sinner and that you need Jesus, and ask Jesus. Open the door of your heart to Jesus today. Don't wait another moment. And there's some out here that have known Jesus, and they're a son or a daughter, but they're like Abraham. They're an Ur, and they need to make a step forward, but the step is just crazy. I don't know what the step is for you. It could be on many different fronts, many different levels, and you're just having a hard time trusting that God's going to keep you from falling. He's going to keep your head above water. If you are the person who needs to make that step away from the Ur in your life, say yes to Jesus. Right now, in your heart, say, Lord, I am going to take that step, and I am just going to trust you. God honors that. All of heaven rejoices when you make that decision. Lord, you've heard the responses to this appeal. And as we're praying, I want to share with each of you that we have our prayer warriors, our prayer team up at the organ side. If you've made the decision, don't let it go by without talking to someone. You might be able to talk to your spouse or maybe a leader or a friend, but we have people that can affirm your decision. Or maybe you have a prayer request where you're sick or ill, or maybe someone else, and you just need someone to pray with you today. We have our prayer warriors up front here. Lord, I just thank you for the decisions that were made today. Lord, allow us to see in the midst of the fog, in the midst of the difficulties, that we are sons, that we are daughters in Jesus Christ. And that is all we need. We thank you and praise you, Lord. And we pray these things in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen.